Sacredness is not limited to a space or a time or even to one group of people. Sacredness comes from the holy, among us and before us, and the one who created us. But sacredness is also what I would define the last 4 years of a college student's life. The people that poured into you, professors, staff members, your friends, others on campus who cheered you along the way. Sacredness is the family, the friends that stood behind you and cheered you on to what is possible, who formed you and made you what you are. But listen, each graduate, you are sacred. And the moment that you are watching this, the space that you are in, is a sacred and beautiful gift. May you feel God among you right now, whether you are watching on a telephone screen, or watching from home, watching amidst all the other commencement events of this weekend. May this be holy ground. May this be a sacred moment. And may what comes next be full of sacred expectation. Amen.
Our first reading comes from the Hebrew Bible, Esther chapter 4, verses 11 through 14. All the king's servants and the people of the king's provinces know that if any man or woman goes to the king inside the inner court without being called, there is but one law. All alike are to be put to death. Only if the king holds out the golden scepter to someone may that person live. I myself have not been called to come in to the king for 30 days. When they told Mordecai what Esther had said, Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, "Do not think that in the king's palace you will escape any more than all the other Jews. For if you keep silence at such a time as this, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another quarter, but you and your father's family will perish. Who knows? Perhaps you have come into the royal dignity for such a time as this."
Psalm 119, verse 33 through 40. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I will observe it to the end. Give me understanding that I may keep your law and observe it with my whole heart. Lead me in the path of your commandments, for I delight in it. Turn my heart to your decrees and not to selfish gain. Turn my eyes from looking at vanities. Give me life in your ways. Confirm to your servant your promise, which is for those who fear you. Turn away the disgrace that I dread, for your ordinances are good. See, I have longed for your precepts. In your righteousness, give me life.
Please join me in prayer. Sustaining God, we gather this day in gratitude for all the work that has gone before us. We are thankful for students who persevere in studies, for teachers who feel a call to open minds and hearts as they mature, for leaders who believe in the future of these students gathered, and in the future of those who are on the journey. Bless this life passage as a doorway into new life, life that is connected with you in all ways. Let ambitions be tampered by your call. Let us all listen closely to what you would have us do, no matter what the world tells us. In the name of the one who gives us life, amen.
Hear now a reading from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 35 through 37 and 41 through 45. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What is it you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left, in your glory." When the ten heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you, but whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many.
Greetings, and thank you for making OCU's baccalaureate service part of your commencement celebration. OCU's history is grounded in faith, and OCU's community continues to be informed by faith. This is most evident in the vibrant religious life on our campus. The significance of faith to our campus community culminates each year with our baccalaureate service. Sacred music is shared from our chapel organ and from our student vocalists. Readings from the Hebrew Bible and Christian New Testament will guide our meditation. Students who have studied at our Wimberley School of Religion will give voice to sacred words, and the preacher is one of OCU's own alumni. In a year that has been full of uncertainties, many have turned to faith to find comfort and answers. That includes many on our campus. May this time of worship call us back to our legacy of faith and invite us to respond to the world in faith. Now it is my pleasure to introduce our baccalaureate preacher, the Reverend Kirt Moelling. Reverend Moelling is the senior pastor of First United Methodist Church of Yukon. He's a 1985 OCU graduate and shares that bond with his father, sister, and two sons. He also has a niece who is currently a freshman here on campus and is continuing the family legacy. Thank you, Reverend Moelling, for leading us in our baccalaureate service today.
First today, let me say congratulations. Let me say congratulations to you graduates on achieving a milestone that's been 4, 4.5, 5, maybe 6, perhaps even 7 years in the making. Hey, it happened. I had a friend who took 7 years. Second, let me say congratulations to you parents or family or other support people who have walked with these graduates, especially if it's been the 6 or 7 year path. And third, I want to say congratulations to you, OCU, for consistently year after year attracting the best and the brightest young minds and transforming them into stars. Being an alum myself, I can say that, and a father of 2 other alums as well. But I also want to say I'm sorry. I'm sorry that a pandemic has changed your plans for your graduation, for your whole senior year, the last 3 semesters if you're a 21 grad. And I'm sorry if it's changed your life in ways that you were not expecting. So many have suffered so much loss in the midst of this. But aside from congratulations and condolences, I want to put you at ease today. I want to take a little pressure off. While what I share today will no doubt be utterly profound and deeply inspiring, the truth is, you probably won't remember it, at least not for long. And that's okay. I tried to recall one thing that any of my speakers said at any of my graduations, and I couldn't think of a one, and I've had a few graduations. In fact, I tried to remember who my commencement speakers were, and except for Bishop Hayes, who was also my boss at the time, and he preached at my seminary graduation, aside from him, I can't remember a single one. And my OCU baccalaureate? Well, neither content nor person do I remember. Now, part of that is bad on me. 36 years of rust since OCU. I'm sure no doubt that they were great people, that they were great speakers, that what they had to share was life-changing in the moment for me. But truth is, my mind was elsewhere, mostly, like yours is as well. Like you, I was ready to go, to move past this milestone, to move on to the next chapter or phase or challenge in life, or at least move on to the graduation dinner. You know, as much fun as OCU was, even for an oldster like me, and it was a lot of fun back then, I was ready to go and to do great things, to put to use what I'd been learning, to make my mark in the world, to be great myself. And kidding aside, I believe you are, as graduates of this blessed university, or soon to be graduates, you are especially poised to do great things and to be great. Now, should that be our goal? Greatness? Is there anything wrong with wanting to be great? Doesn't God want us to excel and achieve and to be great? Actually, I think God does. In fact, I believe that each of you, each of us, are made by God for greatness. And that desire is from God. But the question is, do we understand what greatness really is? In pop culture, greatness typically is viewed as being slotted above others with greater riches, fame, success, power, or praise. We think of politicians, or we used to, billionaires, actors, sports stars, TikTok entrepreneurs and influencers, and yes, somehow even Kardashians still, although I hear this is the last season. But we want to stand out, our achievements to be noticed and praised. And the desire for notoriety is not a new phenomenon. In our gospel reading today, two brothers, James and John, they ask Jesus for a favor. They ask that one can be put on his left and one on his right when he comes into his glory. And what they're asking for are the places of honor right next to Jesus when he comes into power. They want to ride shotgun by the Messiah, a slot above all the others. They want to be great in the world's eyes. And apparently the other disciples do too. They're upset about James and John asking this question of Jesus. They probably want in on it as well. In Atlanta's Ebenezer Baptist Church on February 4th, 1968, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. preached a sermon on our text in Mark chapter 10. It was called The Drum Major Instinct. And with incredible insight, he brings clarity to our questions and our quandary about greatness. He said, quote, "There is deep down within all of us an instinct. It's a kind of drum major instinct, a desire to be out front, a desire to lead the parade, a desire to be first." What was the answer Jesus gave James and John? It's very interesting. One would have thought that Jesus would have said, "You are out of your place. You are selfish. Why would you raise such a question?" But that isn't what Jesus did. He did something altogether different. He said in substance, "Oh, I see. You want to be first. You want to be great. You want to be important. You want to be significant. Well, you ought to be. And if you're going to be my disciple, you must be." Dr. King continued, "Yes, don't give up this instinct. It's a good instinct. If you use it right, it's a good instinct. If you don't distort it and pervert it, don't give it up. Keep the feeling, the need for being first. But," you probably guessed there was a but coming, "but I want you to be first in love. I want you to be first in moral excellence. I want you to be first in generosity. That is what I want you to do." And Jesus, by giving that definition of greatness, says everybody can be great because everyone can serve. Close quote. Each of you today has great potential, unique potential to follow your heart and be exactly who you feel God is calling you to be in the world. Each of you graduates has the wherewithal to be great in whatever you feel called to do in your vocation, as a life partner, as a person. And if you're not yet certain what you're going to do with your life, well, that's okay. I'm two careers past where I thought I would be upon graduation from OCU. And there is some advice out there about how to make these kind of life decisions, but I must warn you to be careful about free advice that you get. One piece of advice I used to share was a quote attributed to Howard Thurman, a wonderful African-American pastor and theologian. And for you religion students and others, his book, Jesus and the Disinherited, is a must read. But this quote attributed to Dr. Thurman is this: don't ask what the world needs, ask what makes you come alive, and go do that, because what the world needs is people who have come alive. Close quote. Wow. That sounds freeing, doesn't it? It does. And I say I used to share this because, well, it said it was Howard Thurman, and at first blush, it sounds appealing. Do what makes you come alive. That's what the world needs. And the quote was often accompanied with a photo of a little girl, right? Or a little boy standing blowing dandelion seeds, or someone standing on the beach with their arms outstretched. Yes. Yes. Do what makes you come alive. Of course. But on further analysis of that quote, something seems amiss. First, the quote never appears in Thurman's writings. It showed up 11 years after his death in the foreword of a book by another author as a remembered snippet of advice they received from Dr. Thurman. Not the greatest provenance, I would say. And then just consider for a moment the first part of this quote. Don't ask what the world needs. No. Just ask what makes you come alive. Just you. Regardless of what the world needs or what is happening, if binge-watching Netflix series in your basement day after day makes you come alive, then do that. If wandering through God's creation in beach and mountain and forest, that makes you come alive, just do it. If eating fine food and sampling the finest wines and having a life of leisure does it for you, then do that. That's what the world needs, if that makes you come alive. Regardless of what the world needs, just focus on you. Do you. On second thought, that sounds very little like pastor and theologian Howard Thurman. Very little. Maybe he did say it. But if he did, I bet it was in passing or was regarding a particular context and was not meant to be a philosophy for making life choices. In our Hebrew scripture that you heard, Esther is a diaspora Jew now living in Persia, the Persian Empire, modern-day Iran. She is a descendant of Jews a generation earlier who had been forcibly displaced from Judah, now in modern Israel, displaced during the Babylonian exile. Esther has been raised by her older cousin Mordecai, who adopted her as his daughter because her parents didn't make it. Persia was the empire du jour, and Esther and Mordecai lived in the Persian city of Susa. And for Jews in the day, they were enjoying relative safety, although that was always in question. Now, Esther was quite beautiful. And when the king of Persia felt disrespected by his current queen, Vashti, he essentially had a kingdom-wide beauty pageant, bringing eligible, fair, young maidens, virgins, into the court. And guess what? Esther won that beauty pageant. Now, per Mordecai's advice, she did not disclose her ethnic or religious background. She kept that a secret. But she was whisked into palace life, and she got the spa treatments deserving of a queen. And she was living the good life, servants, foods, all the fancy creams and lotions. Life was good for Esther. She is great in the world's eyes. But Mordecai, her adopted father, he discovers a plot to exterminate the Jews across the Persian Empire, a genocide. You see, the king had been falsely advised that there were these people, this certain people, that were not respecting the king's laws, and without hearing anything about them, he authorized them to be taken care of however that needed to be done and trusted his underlings to do that. In any event, he certainly did not know that his new queen was part of this people. So when Esther, now the queen, is told of this plot by her adopted father Mordecai, and Mordecai gives her a plea for her to please go before the king and beg for relief and help for the Jews, she sends Mordecai a reply that we heard in that scripture. Quote, "All the king's servants and the people of the king's provinces know that if any man or woman goes to the king inside the inner court without being called, there is but one law, all alike are to be put to death. Only if the king holds out the golden scepter to someone, may that person live. I myself have not been called to come into the king for 30 days. Close quote. And when Mordecai receives this text from Esther, he sends a reply right back to her, quote, "Do not think that in the king's palace you will escape any more than all the other Jews, for if you keep silence at such a time as this, then relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another quarter, but you and your father's family will perish. Who knows? Perhaps you have come to royal dignity for just such a time as this." So Queen Esther, the secret Jew, she has a choice to make. Silence and safety on the one hand, or risk raising her voice and risking it all. And in that moment of reflection, Esther remembers that advice from her baccalaureate. Don't ask what the world needs. Ask what makes you come alive and go do that, because what the world needs is people who have come alive. No, not really. Not really. Esther instead replies to Mordecai, "I will go to the king, though it is against the law, and if I perish, I perish." Esther risked raising her voice for those who could not. And she did not perish, and neither did her people, thanks to her. John Wesley, founder of the Methodist movement, in his commentary on this passage says, quote, "We should, every one of us, consider for what end God has put us in the place that we are. And when an opportunity offers for serving God and our generation, we must take care not to let it slip." So today, I'm asking you graduates, as you venture forth into that promised land of paychecks and possibilities, I'm asking you specifically to ask and regularly what the world needs. Because look around. The world cannot afford for you to not ask that question. But you should also ask and regularly what makes you come alive. Because there at the convergence of your passions and the needs of the world, there you'll find your place to do great things, to be great. There. And that's be great in all the true meanings of that word. The world needs you. And it is for such a time as this, a time of unprecedented crises, distrust, division, and dysfunction, for such a time as this that you are in a position to make a difference, a great difference. You pre-med, biology, and nursing grads, it is for such a time as a pandemic that you have been put in a position to be great. Business grads, you'll have opportunities to make a difference, to change the world when it comes to hiring and diversity and removing barriers for people, for opening doors to opportunity. You grads in education or social or political sciences and criminal justice, oh my, we need you in our schools in serving those left out, in making policy and policing that works for all, that works for the common good. Mass communications and information technology, a world of unprecedented change is there. We need you. Thank you for Zoom, I never thought I'd say. You in environmental sciences, sorry, but we have left a mess of God's creation. And it is for such a time as this that you have been put in a position to foment change in the world, to remind us that we don't live apart from the earth, that she is our only planet, our only home. Music and performing arts grads, we so need you to share and tell stories that tug on our hearts and foment change in ways that sometimes a preacher's words can't, but art can. Don't worry, you religion students. Preacher's words can change the world too. But whatever your chosen field, I want each of you to remember that you are made for greatness, each of you. But I want you to also remember what that really is. I want you to remember Jesus' words and Dr. Martin Luther King's words. Sure, I want you to ask what makes you come alive. Ask that question. But also ask what the world needs for such a time as this. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We are all sent out. Those who participated in our videos are sent out, knowing that this is a beautiful gift of worship. Those who have raised you are being sent out to see you grow and become who you are. And each of those who have graduated this weekend or a year ago, you too are sent out. And we expect beautiful and great things from you, but we also know that we don't own them. You do. And we believe they are a gift to God. Be sent out in peace and grace and love. Amen.